Well, welcome to the show.
Thank you. Thanks for having me. Very exciting.
My pleasure. I want to center this episode around meditation and things of that ilk. But before we get into that, I want to talk a bit about how you built your career, because that's something our audience tend to like hearing about. What was your childhood like, and was acting the dream originally?
Yes. So in my childhood, I'm a first generation American. So my parents immigrated from the Dominican Republic. And so my whole family and everyone in it is from the Dominican Republic, is, you know, from that lifestyle, from a third world country, came to this country with nothing, no money, no English, you know, really nothing. So, I mean, with a lot of intangible things that we can't really measure and that society doesn't care about, like love, but nothing real tangible. So, that's kind of my origin story. And so I grew up in Queens, New York, you know, very much middle class. Like, we had just enough kind of to get by. We weren't poor, but we were paycheck to paycheck. My mom was a teacher. My dad was a postman. So, it was modest, really modest. And certainly no one in my family had ever even really conceived of the idea of being a full-time actor or what that means. Or, I mean, it was like a completely, we had no idea. So, but yeah, it started really young for me. When I was like 8 years old, all the kids in my classroom, the teacher was asking like what they wanted to be when they grew up. And kids were saying like an astronaut and a race car driver and a ballerina. And I couldn't decide. I really wanted to be all of those things. So I figured if I was an actor, I could do them all. Cause, you know, in one movie I would be an astronaut, and the next I'd be a race car driver. And then in the third I could be a ballerina. So that was my logic. And I think, my whole life, very young, my father loves movies. Just, that's our thing. Like my dad and my brother, we just would, you know, go to Blockbuster on a Friday night and rent two or even three movies if we were being crazy, and watch them throughout the weekend. I don't know if your listeners won't know what Blockbuster is. Do you guys know what that is?
Yeah, I mean, we don't have it over here, but I'm sure that, well, I know what it is anyway. I'm sure everyone's familiar with it through, like...
We don't have it anymore either. It's a very... That dates me. That was pre-Netflix. But, yeah. Yeah, the video store. So, yeah, that love started really young. And I think I saw some actors, like, on the Oprah Winfrey Show, watching with my mom. And they just seemed, like, really big people who were doing big things. Like, I remember seeing actors on that show in particular talking about, you know, building wells in Africa or building schools or contributing in some big way. And I thought, wow, this is perfect. You know, I could be creative and be a big person who does meaningful things in the world. So I think, you know, I think it was probably touching on some deeper things on a subconscious level, but that was kind of how I pieced it together as a young child. And then, yeah, I never dropped that obsession and that desire. And I went to performing arts high school. I went to a theater training program for college and did like all the classics, you know, classical training, dance, singing, and acting. And then eventually took the plunge and moved out to Los Angeles, and I didn't know anybody. And I got myself a manager, and I just started auditioning, and it was not easy for me. Like, it's not, I hear these podcasts and I see all these interviews with people who are like, my second audition, I got this show and the rest is history. And that is so not my story. It was like, plugging away for years, and trying different things and learning different things. And really it was when I came to myself through mindfulness, through meditation, that things started to kind of shift in a, you know, in a more impactful way in terms of my career.
Do you feel as though that resilience you had. Like you said, you didn't initially get the first few jobs or whatever, and a lot of people might have given up there, but
the first few hundred
the first few hundred even. I mean, do you think that and that sort of spirit comes from, you know, you said you're first generation American. Do you think that gives you an advantage in the sense that you're now in the what they call the land of opportunity, and you know that you may well not have had those opportunities, or certainly your parents might not have had those opportunities. Do you feel that gives you a sort of better sense of gratitude?
I think my parents made sure to instill in me some of those principles. Certainly hard work. My dad always says hard work never killed anybody, which is actually not true, but you get the idea. Yeah. and a sense of gratitude. Keeping your eye on what's really important and not getting distracted by the noise, or even the successes, the material things. Like, my parents were really big on that. In particular, my father, he has a bit more of a spiritual bent. But as far as me, I didn't know any different. Like, I was just growing up like this little brown-skinned child of immigrants in America. I didn't know to compare it to the Dominican Republic. I've never even been to the Dominican Republic, actually. So it's not like I had that firsthand experience, but I think my parents did, and they were huge on that. And I, on the Oprah Winfrey Show, I remember some young actor was being interviewed one time, and Oprah asked him, I don't remember who it was, but Oprah asked him, what's the best piece of advice you've ever gotten? And he said that he had met Tom Hanks once at like a luncheon or a gifting suite or something. And he asked Tom Hanks for some acting advice. And Tom Hanks took a moment and thoughtfully replied, persevere. That was it. That was his advice. And that stuck with me. I think I probably saw that interview when I was, 13 or something. And that stuck with me. It's just like, what else are you going to do? Give up? Like, come on. That can't be the story. Just keep pushing. I mean, we hear it all the time from actors or motivational speakers or spiritual gurus we know this. And so when it comes down to it, it's like, every rejection, every no, everybody saying, for me, it wasn't like people saying like, oh, you're never going to make it, or you just don't have this. It was more people being like, we don't know why this isn't working. Like, you're so great. We totally believe in you, but just not this time. Or you were really great in the audition, but no, not this time. So it was just, which is even more annoying because it's like some mysterious misalignment. But every time that happens, it's like, okay, well, that's going to have to just fuel me and give me more volition to do it and get it and be it and prove everybody wrong, or prove everybody right who believes in me and just can't quite put their finger on me yet. Or, I can't live with the idea that I was bested by rejection or something, you know?
Yeah, I mean, you mentioned that. You know, that decision you made to move to LA, and I imagine that, I mean, there's, you know, a lot of risk involved there. I mean, you essentially, you know, took a gamble. I mean, what was that decision like, making that decision and weighing up the risk factor of it not working out or working out? Or, you know, you might end up in a position where you're struggling, you're finding it hard to get by. How did you weigh that up in your head, and what made the decision so easy for you in the end?
I was, at the time, I was in my early 20s, and I always knew I wanted to be a movie star. You know, like, again, when I was 8 years old, I was like, oh, okay, I'll just be Denzel. I'll just be Julia. So I knew I had to do it. There were many, many theater opportunities calling me to stay in Minneapolis, where I went to school, and or also New York. And this kind of regional theater lifestyle was like kind of actively seeking my participation. And so I had to come to a point where I said no. I turned down actual jobs for the potentiality of of one day being able to work in Los Angeles. But I just knew it. I don't know. It was, again, it was so deep inside me from when I was very young. It was like at the time, actually, I was in a relationship with somebody who I was with for 6 years. We got together when I was 19 years old, wonderful person. And he hated Los Angeles and he wanted to move back to Minneapolis and be with near his family. And he even would say things like kind of just persuading me, like, this is so hard. Like, do you really want this? Why can't we just go to Minneapolis and be happy and have, you know, a normal life and a nice apartment and get a dog? And, cause LA is rough, you know, I mean, it's expensive, especially when you're starting out, it's expensive. Like, it takes a while to form your tribe, to find your people, to get a good community going, to feel like you know what you're doing. So that's quite tempting when someone's kind of offering you this cushy, like, just pull the ejection cord on your dream. But I don't know. I guess I don't know how to explain that kind of beast within me that's like, no, I got to make it. I got to do it on my own. I got to, like, I have to see this through. Like, I have to see what's possible. But I do remember one time when I was in high school, my mom, it was senior year and I was thinking about where to go for college. And I was a smart kid. I had good grades and stuff. And I had many different interests. And I asked my mom, you know, maybe I should go to school to be a lawyer because I love arguing. I love, like, rational debate, and or a doctor because I'm fascinated by the human body. Because being an actor seems really, really hard. And she said, you know what's hard, Elizabeth, is going to a job every day that you hate. That's really, really hard. And I was like, whoa. Wow, mic drop. So, yeah, I think my parents just having that mentality, like, you got one life, like, take your shot, you know, and whatever happens, I don't know, even if I got to a point in LA where it's like, okay, you know, I don't know, I'm still figuring all this out. Maybe who knows where it'll all lead, but at least I can kind of feel like I really was taking swings, you know?
When you originally were out there and like you said, you were facing hundreds of rejections, were you doing anything at the time to supplement, you know, living costs essentially, or were you just about getting by?
Oh yeah, I was waiting tables. I waited tables for years and years and years. I never had, you know, my family, I mean, they helped with, you know, paying for my education as best as they could. But once that was up and I was an adult, like no checks were being sent my way by mom and dad. So again, that's like a very, I think it's another like hardworking immigrant thing. Like you got to go to work. My parents would always be like, you're young and you have an able body, go to work. There's no reason why you can't. So yeah, I worked on my feet and I took people's orders and carried dishes and plates and all of this for years, like 5 nights a week or something. And I was still kind of getting by. I learned a lot about money when I, as I've learned more about kind of the universe and spirituality and the way things actually are. And one of the things I learned about, the main thing is that like money is like, it's kind of a mentality. It's an energy that flows and we can kind of align with it or not, but by how we think. And I think unfortunately, not unfortunately, but the other side of the coin of like, you know, being a hardworking, coming from that immigrant mentality, like you got to work hard, you got to go get it. That's all wonderful. And it certainly made me who I am. I'm sure you can hear it in my voice, but the flip side of that coin is kind of like this, unconscious belief that things need to be a struggle and that you need to struggle in order for things to be like worthwhile, or that anything worth having you have to struggle for. Again, maybe there is some truth in those statements, but I find that things flow to me a lot easier when I swap those out for like other thoughts, like money comes to me easily, I receive easily. This doesn't have to be that hard. I can just like kind of glide into my jobs and my situations, my circumstances, if that makes sense.
Yeah, I mean, where do you find that, you know, in a career like acting, where do you find the balance between what's paying the bills the most and what makes you happy? Where do you sort of weigh up your decisions based on those things?
Well, to be 100% honest with you, paying the bills makes me happy.
Yeah, that's a great answer.
It really does. It really does. So, yeah, I don't know. I'm certainly an artist, and I love, you know, doing things that are meaningful and thinking about things in a meaningful way, regardless of what I'm doing. I hate feeling really cheap, like I'm doing something just for money. There have been jobs, even maybe not that long ago, like a few years ago, I got a recurring role on a TV show that I had, when I auditioned for it, I had a full scene of lines and I knew I had to do a sex scene with the lead character. And then when I got to set, the first thing I did was the sex scene. And then, when I got to my lines, they cut them all and there was only one sentence. And that was a moment of like, oh God, like I'm not a porn star. Like, what am I doing? Like, this is not it, you know? And that it just really hurt. It just hurt to feel kind of cheapened. So, you know, things like that, it's like, okay, that ain't it. You know what I mean? Like, I'd rather tables. But on the other hand, I don't know, I did a huge campaign for Mercedes-Benz where we got to travel for 10 days, and that set me up financially in a wonderful way for like the rest of that year. And I don't look down on that. I don't go, oh, it's just a commercial. I'm just doing commercials. Like, I can't, like, to get by, I can't wait to do film. I'm like, no, that was awesome. And I loved it. And I can't wait to do some more stuff like that. So I just, it brings me joy to pay the bills. So I find a lot of joy in all different types of work.
Yeah. On your website, one of the things that struck me was on your about section, you define yourself as the universe unfolding in ecstatic wonder about itself and more than the sum of my experiences. And you also suggest that this is true of us all. For those who are, like myself, not so profound as you, maybe, could you elaborate on that and sort of explain what that means in more simple terms?
Well, I think what I was pointing at is that we're more than the stories we tell about ourselves in our mind. Like, we all have this set of like rehearsed stories that we repeat over and over, like hundreds and thousands of times a day in our minds. Like, I am Elizabeth. I am the daughter of immigrants. I am an actress. I am Dominican. I'm a woman. Those are, in relative terms, those things are true, but when we practice mindfulness, when we practice meditation, we start to realize that there's more than that. And it creates kind of a more sense of like an openness and an open space for kind of more possibility. And this is all quite a difficult thing to explain or conceptualize, because that's the point, is that it goes beyond concept and language, because concept and language are of the mind. But I did the best I could in the about me and on my website. It's like hinting at the idea, because I say things like, I am I'm joyful and I'm full of rage. I'm courageous and I'm terrified. The idea being that like I'm not one thing and it's changing, and kind of in a subtle way encouraging the reader and reminding myself to identify more with this sense of awareness of what is arising right now rather than the thing that's arising. So I can be kind of this like witness consciousness, some people have called it, of like, oh, okay, anger is arising, joy is arising, And again, it's a really tricky thing to kind of talk about, but I, for example, you know, with the acting thing, I identified so strongly as an actress, almost to where it became too precious and too rigid. Like, that was such a huge part of my identity that I had to prove myself as an actress. When I went into audition rooms, I think people could feel that sense of gravity to how much it meant to me and how seriously I took it. And I would get so frustrated because friends of mine who had never acted a day in their life and were just like, you know, whatever, just like vibing it out, figuring it out, would go into auditions and get like really big roles on big productions. And, you know, and I was there like, I have a degree in acting. I have studied it. I have done every beat of this character. And I wasn't even getting the callback. So that would confuse me. And I started, one of my main mentors in the mindfulness and meditation space is a teacher called Chandresh, friend of mine from India. And he was one of the first people I really started going deep into practice with. And he would guide us in this meditation where he just repeats the mantra, who am I? Who am I? Who am I? And he guides you to kind of watch the answers enter and exit your field of awareness. Like, I'm an actress, I'm a la la la. And just let them exit, like just kind of soften. And that was really big for me. It was actually quite scary to drop or even soften the identity of being an actress. But when I did, it was really powerful. The energy moved and I was like, oh, I'm much more than that. I'm this living being, this breathing creature here. You know, I'm alive. And I think so when we soften our stories about ourselves, it opens us up to be able to change and not repeat patterns so much. And also to feel into our aliveness. And that's pretty cool. I think it's been big for me.
Yeah. At what point in your life did you start tapping into this sort of way of thinking? And when did you start exploring these ideas? How old were you?
Gosh, let's see. I probably started walking toward practice around like age 26 or 27. It may have been around age 25 when my best friend bought me the book The Power of Now by Eckhart Tolle.
Yeah,
classic. Then that blew my mind. It's really cool. Have you read that book?
Yeah, I do have it, yeah.
Did you have that experience when you were reading that book where, like, you actually felt a shift in your consciousness? Like, you were reading it at the right time for you where your brain was like, oh.
Yeah, no, I know what you mean exactly.
Me too. It was really big. That bit where he talks about the how much empty space there is in every room we're in, how much silence there is. I got that. Like, I was like reading the books, laying in my bed, and I was like, oh shit. You know?
So would you say that, I mean, I guess those would be two mentors you've mentioned. Are there any other mentors that you continue to learn from?
Absolutely. Yeah. My main teacher in mindfulness in particular is a woman called Heather Preet, P-R-E-T-E. And she has some wonderful online offerings, online meditations and things. Although, to be honest, there's nothing quite like sitting with her in real life. She teaches here in Los Angeles. She comes from a long 20-year history of training and teaching in the Buddhist compassion practices, Tibetan Buddhism, and then segueing that into secular mindfulness. So taking out kind of the rituals and iconography of Buddhism, but keeping the principal teachings. She teaches at UCLA. UCLA has a great program for mindfulness as well, the Mindfulness Awareness Research Center, if people are interested. But yeah, Heather is an ongoing close friend and mentor of mine. And I also really love the book, The Untethered Soul by Michael Singer. Have you read that book?
No, I haven't.
Oh, I'm so excited for you. You've got to check out that book, The Untethered Soul. That's another, in the same kind of sphere as The Power of Now, in terms of when you read it and when you're ready for it, it really opens up. It can open up like new doors in your consciousness. It's a really cool book.
Cool. I've just actually made note of that now. So
yeah, you read it, please email me and let me know what you think.
I will do. I will do. Aside from its impact on your career, your acting career, mm-hmm. what has the practice of meditation and mindfulness done for you as an individual? If you look at yourself prior and post finding meditation and mindfulness, what are the things you've noticed have changed?
Yeah, I love that question. Wow. It has made me more grounded and present and resilient, particularly in the sense of being able to hold space. Like, I feel like before, like my entry point, my kind of conditioning when I came in was like super codependent, people pleaser, really anxious. And I don't know, that my teacher Heather, she always says, like, if we're like in fight or flight mode, we can't really help in a crisis. You know, the people who are like super compassionate, you know, like hypersympathetic, no boundaries, you know, highly, they call themselves, and I'm one of these people, highly sensitive person, empath, an intuit, this type of person. Without any practice, you're just like somebody, if somebody's like, you know, calls you crying or something, or is like super freaked out, or has had an accident or has been diagnosed with an illness, your response is like, no, I'm crying. I'm so upset with you. Like, oh my God. And that's really sweet and all, but you can't really help if you're thrown into your parasympathetic or your fight or flight response. So I think that was a bit how I was. And that's how many of us are when we're highly intuitive, highly sensitive people. And no one teaches us these things in the West, you know, like self-compassion and mindfulness. And so we have to figure it out the hard way. And first, you have to go through years of, or I had to go through years of like toxic codependent relationships and self-sabotage and stuff. So I think that I've seen a marked difference in certainly in those ways, the quality of my relationships, my romantic relationships, the patterns have changed. And that's because of time spent sitting with myself and giving myself a lot of the things that I need, that I was seeking outward. And then this isn't a mindfulness thing, but I was kind of touching on like the money thing, or, you know, Louise Hay is another inspirational person, her affirmations, and Abraham Hicks, just learning a little bit about like, all right, how can I use my mind to help me instead of like get in my way? And that has resulted in me having a lot more success and being more comfortable and not having to serve tables anymore. And then I think, you know, with myself and really with others, I see a marked difference in terms of if somebody, you know, is going through something or needs to get something off their chest, or a friend, or, you know, when they speak with me now versus before, I'm not giving them advice. I'm not telling them what they should do. I honor others with the great honor of saying, I don't know what's best for you, but I'm here for you. I love you. You know, that's a big thing. When we don't know any better, I was like, back in the day, I was like giving advice, like kind of, it's just a less skillful way of being. It really is.
Okay. So for someone who may be listening to you speak right now, and they're thinking, you know, Elizabeth sold me on the benefits of meditation, mindfulness. I want to start, but I don't know how. I'm not the spiritual type. It looks complicated. I don't know where to start. I don't know what that first step is. What or where is the easiest, the most basic place that they can start to practice these things? How simple can it be to start out?
Yeah. I love that. Yeah, because it's so true. Like, it can feel so hippy dippy and so complex. I really like the idea of starting with 5 minutes. 5 minutes in the morning. This is what I did. I sat down for 5 minutes on my carpet on a pillow, and I literally set an alarm on my phone for 5 minutes and tried to, for 5 minutes, just bring my awareness to my breath and my body and the present moment. And then whenever my mind carried me away, just notice it and then come back to my breath for 5 minutes. And I remember the first time I did that, I thought the alarm on my phone must have broken because it felt like an hour. I was like, is this, are people seriously doing this? This is insane. It's so hard. But it gets easier. It gets easier pretty quickly, you know. And it just goes to show how untrained our minds are and our inability to sustain focus. So I think that's the best way to start. Just 5 minutes. Just breathing, coming back to the breath, coming back to the breath. But it is difficult like that to start on your own. So there's some great resources online. The meditation studio where I discovered practice is called the Den Meditation, D-E-N. And it's in Los Angeles, but they actually have like a full online presence. And especially now because of the quarantine, all of the classes are virtual. So that's super fun. You can kind of practice. Another great one is an app called Insight Timer, where there's thousands of free meditations. And the nice thing about those is they're kind of short. Like, I think when you're beginning, just don't try to do too much. Just do 10 minutes, 5 minutes. And then a big mentor of mine, who I love so much, is a woman named Tara Brach. Her last name is B-R-A-C-H. And she has a free podcast, a lot of talks online, free meditations on her podcast and online. And that woman, wow. That's a great resource for people because you can kind of listen to her talk, you can feel the vibe, and then she might guide you to close your eyes for a minute, but it's nothing like where you have to feel like you're diving off a cliff, you know?
Yeah. I'll try my best to link some of those resources in the description.
Yeah, I have to email as well, like all the things I'm talking about.
Oh, fantastic. Something you've touched on already, just a slight bit, but I'd like to go into a bit more, is that idea of self-compassion. Why is that such an important practice?
Self-compassion is really important because we actually... everything we do in life is kind of like a projection. How we treat others is actually a projection of how we've treated ourselves and how others have treated us. And we're repeating a lot of things that we've learned from when we were children. So self-compassion offers us the opportunity to break up the pattern, to create new. Without that, without mindful self-compassion, we end up, and this is science. It's not a spiritual thing. It's a psychology thing. We end up repeating our conditioning. You know, that's why people who have been maybe abandoned or neglected or abused as small children may find themselves repeating some of those behaviors as in adulthood, or maybe dealing with addiction in adulthood, or having a difficulty keeping a healthy, intimate relationship in adulthood. Like, it's that inner child. So with mindful self-compassion, it's like you're stepping into now in a very real way, the present moment. And then in the present moment, you're actually interacting with these parts within you that are, that have felt perhaps quite neglected or ignored or abused even. And we all have them. No one gets out of childhood totally unscathed. And that's by design, actually. That's the point. No one's childhood was supposed to be perfect. There's no such thing as a perfectly aligned parent. This is a skill that we're supposed to cultivate and we actually need to have. And when we do that, we can start to offer outward to, you know, our partners, to our children, to our community, something a little bit more skillful, a little bit more useful than maybe the cross wiring that we had gotten when we were kids. Am I making any sense?
Yeah, no, absolutely. The one thing I'd like to sort of add on to that question, for those listening and myself, because this is something I was a bit drawn to when I saw it, is the way in which we can practice it. I mean, like, what are some of the ways that we can practice our self-compassion on a daily basis? What are some of the first steps we can take then?
Yeah, well, just checking in with yourself, taking a deep breath and just kind of checking in, like, how's my body? Where is there tension? All right, my shoulders are a little tight. I can soften those. Oh, okay. Just kind of checking in. How am I doing? You know, when's the last time I had a glass of water? Little things like that are super helpful. And then we can take it further. If, you know, I sit on a daily basis these days, with the quarantine and everything kind of being changed in my life, it's not as consistent as it once was and as it will be again. But anyway, you know, sitting and just checking in with yourself physically, taking a deep breath, and then maybe taking it a step further, checking in with your inner world. Like, how are you doing? How are you doing, sweetheart? Thich Nhat Hanh talks about it. He's the Zen master, a Zen master. And another, oh man, what a guy, what a mentor. He talks about it as, it's like the big brother, how the big brother interacts with the little brother who scraped his knee. You know, it's like you have the five-year-old who just scraped his knee and it's bleeding and he's crying. And the first thing you say isn't like, you shouldn't have run so fast. Why didn't you be more careful? That's not how we treat a little one who's hurting. We say, oh, sweetheart, I know that hurts. Come here. I got you. I'm here. I love you. And so we can start to treat ourselves in this way, but we don't. Instead, when we're in pain, we come down on ourselves pretty hard because we think that that'll decrease the chances of us making that mistake again in the future, but it doesn't. The research shows that self-flagellation like that, actually it reinforces the neural pathways that led to that behavior in the first place, which is why like addiction cycles are quite hard to break. So it's like the shame and the punishment, that's actually not helping. So we have to find a way to kind of, you know, not be angry with ourselves for being angry or not be afraid of fear, like to break the, it's really a trip mentally because you're like, all right, I'm trying to outsmart myself in a way. But the simplest way to look at it is taking that deep breath, dropping down into your heart center and coming at yourself with this kind of heartfulness. Again, like the big brother, like, what do you need right now?
I think that brother analogy is a fantastic way to sum it up, because I guess thinking about it, that self-talk is something that people just, you don't really give a second thought to, really. You don't stop and think about that sort of thing.
Yeah, no kidding. Actually, I've told this story a couple of times, but it was such a big moment for me, and just, again, relating to the acting thing. My teacher, Heather, who I mentioned, she had been teaching me about these things that we're talking about. Like, okay, I can, oh, there's a person in here. Like, and this person deserves love as much as any other person on the planet. So I started practicing in that way. Yeah, mindful self-compassion. One day I was driving in the car and I started to have anxiety. Another thing, very important thing about anxiety, it's like a check engine light in your car. It's just your body going, hey, need a little attention here. we look at it as a bad thing or some kind of mental disorder, but actually it's a very healthy body signaling to you, hey, I need some attention and care. So I had learned this. And I was like, oh, okay. I was driving in the car and I had some kind of low-grade anxiety, like my heart just started pounding a little faster, the butterflies in my stomach, my throat started to tighten. But I had practiced a little bit enough to be like, oh, something's happening. The check engine light. Let me go check. What's up? And so still while in the car, I just took a breath and I just kind of checked in with myself. Like, what's up, sweetheart? What's going on? And this little voice from deep down inside me was like totally freaking out and screaming, what if I never make it as an actress? What if I'm not good enough and I never get on a TV show? And I was like, oh shit. You think that? Some voice in there is afraid of that. I didn't know that. But if I didn't know that and that was kicking around, then isn't that kicking around when I go into an audition? Or when I work on the material or when I show up on set? You know, so this is what I mean when I go, oh, there's stories that are floating back there that have, you know, up until we start practicing, been kind of unexamined. And really, they're not threatening. They just need a little love and attention and the really wonderful reminder that, like, you don't have to believe everything you think. Like, just because a little voice in me is screaming that doesn't mean it's true. And so I just interacted with it again, like the big brother and the little brother. Like, oh, okay, I know that's scary. I'm here for you. And then I think that right there empowered me in a new way the next time I went into an audition room, you know? And that's really when things started to click in my acting career.
It's amazing to me to think that there can be these insecurities, these anxieties deep down that we're not even that conscious of or that we don't pay enough attention to even realize they're there.
Yeah. And it's human nature, you know, it doesn't mean that anything's wrong with you or it's actually like, I think all of us, like every single one of us. And there's this very human one that I think is at the core of all of it, which is like, I'm not worthy of love. Something's wrong with me. That Tara Brach calls it the trance of unworthiness. And it's really widespread. It's just human. It's just biological. It comes from our fear of being, of dying and of being left behind by our pack, by our tribe. So it's like, this is our work to do, you know, and we can go in for 5 minutes a day. You can start with 2 minutes a day, whatever. Like, you can just take a deep breath and maybe put your hand on your heart or just give yourself like a little soothing touch. And just that, I think it starts to open the door, make that change possible. And then what's really cool is when you start to imagine like, oh, okay, what would I be like without that thought? What does Elizabeth look like who's and it's not about banishing the voice, like, shut up, go away. It's actually like loving it, like, oh, sweetheart, I'm here for you, and holding it and caring. And then the voice is soothed and then you feel better. And then what does that Elizabeth look like walking into rooms, into audition rooms, onto set, or into relationships to go on a first date and be this kind of like soothed person who thinks they're worthy of love? Like, that sounds pretty great. I think we need more of that in the world.
I think that brings the mindfulness full circle there. And obviously that is a habit that you've developed that is crucial to you at this point and your success in your career. But mindfulness aside for the moment, sure, what are some of the most important habits you have developed aside from meditation, self-compassion, mindfulness?
That's an interesting question for me, because I'm kind of I don't know how to describe myself in terms of like kind of developing habits. A big thing that I learned the past 2 years, and especially through the practice that we're talking about, is taking it more easy with myself and actually not imposing rhythms and structures and shoulds on myself as much as I had been. So I've been for years now taking weight off of my shoulders, not adding more on. And so I have a real sense of flow and a sense of curiosity about like my natural rhythms. Like some days I want to go to a workout class and work out, and some days I don't. And when I don't, I don't. You know, I'm not like Monday, Wednesday, Friday at noon. I'm not that person. So in terms of cultivating habits, it's like my answer is probably going to be a little different than a lot of people's to this question. But in a way, I think that's a habit that I've been cultivating.
Yeah, I was about to say it's almost a habit in itself not to develop habits.
Yeah, like the habit of... Sorry, I don't know how to get my thing to stop doing that.
It's all good. All
right, yeah, I don't know how to use technology. But yeah, the habit of ease and the habit of becoming curious about my natural rhythms. That's been really big for me, especially as a woman. Like, you know, there's a lot going on that we don't know, we don't see. And again, as an empath or someone who's intuitive, or, you know, someone who's very sensitive, people who are listening to this who are that way, they know who they are. Those type of people, it's like our habit is resting when we're tired. Our habit is creating boundaries in relationships, or creating boundaries when we go out, or the habit of self-care, taking long baths, burning Palo Santo around my apartment, checking in with my mom and dad on a regular basis, eating really nourishing foods, going for walks in the evening. You know, there's a real kind of sense of ease to my life. But yeah, that's kind of how I like it.
Amazing. I have four questions left for you now. They are non-specific. They are the four questions we ask everyone that comes on the show.
Cool.
The first one is, if you could issue a challenge to our audience, so something they can take from this podcast and start doing today that is going to in turn benefit their life somehow, what would your challenge to everyone be?
I would challenge everyone listening to this to take 5 minutes in the morning every day to care for yourself and your body. That could be sitting for 5 minutes and noticing thoughts and coming back to breath. That could be taking 5 minutes in the morning to just kind of stretch, you know, and just breathe deeply. But taking 5 minutes to go more deeply into the body and soften the mind in a caring way. That would be so epic if everybody did that. Oh my God. And come find me on my Instagram and tell me all about it.
I'm sure they will. You mentioned at the top of the call, The Untethered Soul. Are there any other books you've read throughout your life that have had an impact on you?
Oh my gosh, yes. So The Untethered Soul, I also mentioned The Power of Now. I love A New Earth, also by Eckhart Tolle. Yeah. The book A Return to Love by Marianne Williamson, which is basically a succinct version of A Course in Miracles. There's this tiny little book by Deepak Chopra I really like called The Seven Spiritual Laws of Success. So cool, so helpful.
Perfect. I will I'll include them in the description as well.
Yay.
Are there any societal rules or societal norms that you love to break/go against?
Oh my God.
like, sorry, that's a really deep question.
All of them. I think for me, like, I've learned how valuable it is to say no. Say no to an invitation. Say no. As Tracy Ellis Ross says, no is a complete sentence. In particular, as a woman and as a woman of color, it's huge. We have to learn that. We have to learn to say, no, I'm not doing that. I don't want to do that. No, thanks. And then again, as a woman of color, as a person of color, the question of societal norms or society's image of you or the way society is projecting things onto you are conditioning through society, it becomes a very different question. And it becomes really even more of a Herculean feat for those folks, those marginalized folks, to see themselves through the eyes of love and worthiness. So I feel like every time I sit down and practice as a person of color, I am breaking societal norms.
Amazing. Okay, so for this last question, I apologize, as it is probably the hardest one to answer. So it's every guest's least favorite question, but it's the audience's favorite question. So take as much time as you want to think of an answer. I can always edit it to make it seem like you've answered it really fast, and it'll be really impressive. So don't worry.
Oh, great.
Okay, so the question is, if you picture a scenario in which you are broadcasting and every person in the world is tuned into the same frequency, and you're given the opportunity to broadcast a short but impactful message, and every person in the world is going to hear every word you say, what would your message be?
The thing that pops to my mind is, you are worthy. You belong. And you can choose to love instead of fear every moment. And that can be your gift to the world.
Fantastic. That's a brilliant answer. Thank you for that.
Thank you. This was like the best. Oh my God.
Have you enjoyed the conversation?
So much. I've done quite a bit of like different, you know, podcasts and press and things. And normally we are talking exclusively about work stuff. So it's been really incredible I'm really curious to see how, you know, your audience responds to it and if it resonates with people. And I really do hope that folks come and connect with me and let me know, because I do these practices at home and it's kind of all kicking around in my head, so I'm curious like how it resonates with others.
Perfect. So on that, where can our audience find you on social media or websites, etc.? Where can they connect?
My Instagram is the best place because I'm the most active on there. It's my name, Elizabethagrullon. And I also have a website, www.elizabethgrullon.com. And my Twitter is @TheEliGru, the first three letters of my first and last name. But again, I'm really more active on Instagram.
Okay.
So that's the most fun place.
Yeah, I'll make sure that's the one that's plugged below then.
Cool. Yeah. Perfect.
Perfect. So thank you very much for your time. I've really enjoyed this conversation, and I'll be sure to follow up with my thoughts on the untethered soul and everything else.
Please do. And thank you so much. Thank you for your questions. I had a blast doing this. So, and I hope you and yours are all well during the